all of you tonight. It's a great honor to be able to address the brigade. I can't thank all of you enough for this tremendous opportunity and an opportunity to see all of you and then to kick off what will be a tremendous leadership conference. So I can't thank Taylor enough for that kind introduction. And I'm honored to have the opportunity to address you, the future leaders and officers of our American Navy and Marine Corps, the greatest naval force the world has ever known. And I know, you know, we focus on the competition and everything, but all the soldiers in the Army know we couldn't even get to the fight if it wasn't for the United States Navy. And all of us who have fought have depended on you to get us there and to be there with us in every fight we've ever been in. So it's a real proud moment for me to be with all of you today. So I want to thank your great superintendent, your great commandant for this tremendous opportunity. Admiral Mrs. Carter, thank you for the great welcome in your home this evening. It is a real privilege to be with all of you, and also meet Mr. and Mrs. Mitch Hart, who have done so much for the Academy and who are sponsoring this wonderful conference you're going to have. It's an all-star lineup for sure. So, Midshipman, visiting you from Washington, D.C. is restorative. All gathered here tonight in this magnificent hall, named for Fleet Admiral Ernest J. King, class of 1901, Chief of Naval Operations during World War II, all of you have chosen a career of service. It's restorative to be with you because you embody values that are vital to securing our nation and our way of life. Honor, courage, commitment. I thought that I might share with you tonight, at the outset of the Naval Academy Leadership Conference, how we might think about preparing to lead under challenging conditions consistent with those values. But first, I want to highlight the tremendous rewards of service, this great career you have chosen. And these rewards are what bind us together across all the services, and they transcend competitions between us, even Army Navy. When you graduate, where's the class of 2018? It's going to be here before you know it. You will lead men and women who are devoted to serving our nation and eager to be part of endeavors bigger than themselves. At a time when so much of our discourse in our nation today divides us or centers on narcissistic preoccupation with self, you will build cohesive teams of selfless sailors and Marines. Sailors and Marines bound together by common values, mutual respect, trust in you as their leader, and faith in one another. You will feel tremendous pride as you see your teams of sailors and Marines achieve excellence. And you might reflect on the uniqueness of our profession, a profession in which the man or woman next to you is willing to give everything, including their own lives, for you and for each other. That is not replicated anywhere else in our society. So I'm excited for you, because you're going to have fun. You're going to have fun as you reap the rewards of service among the finest Americans. I know that I speak for Admiral Carter and all of the old, even Sadler here. I mean the really old Sadler. Not Joe Sadler. I mean Season. I meant Season. You guys are so lucky to have Joe Sadler. I'm telling you, guys and gals. He's amazing. He's one of my heroes. But I got to tell you, all of us would be happy. We'd be happy to trade places with you. But we all old soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines, we also know that you'll face tough times. You'll endure physical hardships. You'll face uncertainty and danger in battle. and you may have to cope with difficult moments, such as the loss of fellow sailors and Marines. In those most difficult moments, you will rely on your brothers and sisters in arms for support. But they will look to you, they'll look to you to lead them. They'll look to you to help them grieve. And they'll look to you to inspire them to overcome tough times and drive on to accomplish the mission. So today, I'd like to discuss with you, how do you prepare? How do you prepare to meet the challenge of leading teams to fight and win under difficult conditions? What Army Brigadier General, retired Brigadier General Tom Colden calls in extremis leadership. You're not going to read about this topic in business management books. That is because in battle, leaders must demonstrate that they put the needs of the mission and the survival and well-being of their followers before their own well-being, and thus inspire them to act in ways that are contrary to the instinct of self-preservation. I believe that your preparation to lead America's sons and daughters in extremis has three dimensions: intellectual, emotional, and ethical. This three-dimensional preparation will help you lead, overcome obstacles, seize opportunities, and win. I would like to share with you my thoughts about each of these, and then hear where you'd like to start the conversation that you're going to have here over the next 3 days. First, intellectual. Our nation expects us, military professionals, to be experts in war and warfare, because failures of intellect or imagination in war bears too heavy of a price. And because learning by direct experience in war is costly, the military professional is compelled to study the wars of the past. The great historian Sir Michael Howard likened the military professional to a swimmer who had to spend his whole life practicing on dry land for an Olympic championship on which the fortunes of his entire nation depended. But how might we learn from the experiences of those who have gone before us? Michael Howard's 1961 essay, I highly recommend it, entitled The Use and Abuse of Military History, is a brilliant guide. Howard tells us that the study of history is valuable, not because it provides an exact playbook for how to act in the future. History can't tell us what to think. It teaches us how to think as we gain an appreciation for the complex causality of events. History teaches us to ask the right questions. So to prepare yourselves intellectually to lead in extremis, I encourage you to read, think about, and discuss history as Howard suggests, in width, depth, and context. First, in width, to observe how warfare has developed over a long historical period, and gain an appreciation for continuities in the nature of war, as well as changes in the character of warfare. Next, in depth, to study campaigns and explore them thoroughly. This is important, Howard observed, because as the tidy outline that you see in history books, oftentimes, it dissolves, and you catch a glimpse of the confusion and horror of real experience. Last, in context, because victory or defeat in war depends not on military, only on military, but also on social, cultural, economic, human, moral, political, and psychological factors. Second, emotional. Because it is impossible to replicate in training the psychological demands of real danger, the study of history helps us understand the emotional dimension of in extremis leadership. We often focus on changes in warfare driven by changes in technology, but military leaders should spend at least as much time thinking about continuities in the nature of war. The psychological and emotional strains of battle is one of the most important continuities for you to understand as a lieutenant or an ensign. As John Keegan observes in The Face of Battle, his classic 1976 study of combat across five centuries, and this looked at three battles across five centuries that all occurred in generally the same geographic area. And what he concluded is, he said, what battles have in common is human. The behavior of men struggling to reconcile their instinct for self-preservation, their sense of honor, and the achievement of some aim over which other men are ready to kill them. The study of battle is, therefore, always a study of fear and usually of courage, always of leadership, usually of obedience, always of compulsion, sometimes of insubordination, always of anxiety, sometimes of elation or catharsis, always of uncertainty and doubt, misinformation and misapprehension, usually also of faith and sometimes of vision, always of violence, sometimes also of cruelty, self-sacrifice, compassion. Above all, it is always a study of solidarity, and usually also of disintegration, for it is toward the disintegration of human groups that battle is directed. So Keegan's study of battle from Agincourt to Waterloo to the Somme reveals that your first priority as new ensigns and lieutenants is to build confident, cohesive teams that are bound together by mutual trust and a common commitment to our nation, and maybe most importantly, to each other. You do that through tough, realistic training. Confidence and cohesion serve as psychological protection and bulwarks against combat stress and fear in battle. Much of the stress that soldiers experience in combat stems from uncertainty and doubt. Training must, therefore, replicate the conditions of combat as closely as possible. Build bad information and change in your training. And recognize it's okay to fail. It's okay to fail in training because good units push the limits of their capabilities. Units that experience the confusion and intensity in battle for the first time are susceptible to fear. Fear is dangerous because it can cause inaction. It can create opportunities for the enemy. In her book, Stoic Warriors, Nancy Sherman, holder of the Distinguished Chair of Ethics here in Annapolis from 1997 to 1999, quotes the ancient Stoic philosopher Seneca to emphasize the importance of training as a form of bulletproofing warriors against the debilitating effects of fear. Seneca wrote, "A large part of the evil consists in its novelty. But if evil has been pondered beforehand, the blow is gentle when it comes." Training under challenging and realistic conditions prepares units to respond immediately and together in combat. This was made clear to me on February 26, 1991, as Eagle Troop 2nd Squadron, 2nd Armored Cavalry Regiment made contact with the Talokana Division of the Iraqi Republican Guard during Operation Desert Storm. After cresting an imperceptible rise behind which an Iraqi brigade had established a reverse slope defense, our troop came into contact. After a brief fight with an enemy outpost, our tanks had taken the lead. As we crested that rise in the terrain, the extensive enemy position became visible. Within a minute, everything in the range of our guns was in flames. As Eagle Troop advanced, we engaged additional armored vehicles and large numbers of infantry who were dug in between the vehicle fighting positions. After about 20 minutes of fierce combat, we encountered the enemy's reserve at close range atop a subsequent ridgeline. We stopped our advance only when we had nothing left to shoot. Our cavalry troopers destroyed an Iraqi brigade without suffering a single casualty. As Seneca advised, we had pondered the evil of intense battle, and the blow was gentle on us, but not on the enemy. Reflecting on the experience afterwards, the troopers recalled how training had developed confidence in themselves, their leaders, and their team. That confidence was the primary factor, I believe, in that lopsided victory. Specialist Rodrigo Martinez wrote that he never really experienced fear because we had trained so hard and so often, it just seemed like another field problem. The sensory experience of battle, deafening noise, multiple fireballs, thick smoke, it could have been overwhelming. As our troop attacked, however, soldiers executed battle drills flawlessly and had faith in their leaders. My loader, Specialist Taylor, said, "Hey, sir, I'm not gonna lie, I was fixing to panic. But I said, don't panic, just do your job." Staff Sergeant John McReynolds recalled that the crew didn't have to be told what to do. It just kind of came naturally. Lieutenant Timothy Gauthier observed that his platoon's actions were almost businesslike. Now, the third and final dimension of preparation for in-extremis leadership, ethical. Prior to the wars in Afghanistan and in Iraq, ethical training and preparation for combat was centered on the law of war and the Uniform Code of Military Justice. It was inadequate. As Christopher Coker observes in The Warrior Ethos, individual and institutional values are more important than legal constraints on immoral behavior. Legal contracts are often observed only as long as others honor them, or as long as they are enforced. Experience in Afghanistan and in Iraq inspired our military to emphasize values education as the principal means of ensuring moral and ethical conduct in combat. Values such as your values of honor, courage, and commitment, taught, reinforced, and most importantly, internalized by the group. That's what comprises our warrior ethos. It is our warrior ethos that permits soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines to see ourselves as part of an ongoing historical community. You can sense this, that in this hall, on this campus. A community that sustains itself through sacred trust and a covenant that binds us to one another and to the society we serve. Through this sacred trust, your sailors and Marines will understand that their fellow warriors expect them to exhibit a higher sense of honor than they're exposed to in popular culture. It is particularly important for your warriors to recognize that they are expected to take risks and make sacrifices to accomplish the mission, protect their fellow warriors, and safeguard innocence. A great example of someone who prepared himself intellectually, emotionally, and ethically for in-extremis leadership is one of the most distinguished graduates of this great institution. A man I had the great privilege to know and admire greatly. I imagine you already know his story. On 9 September 1965, while flying from a mission over North Vietnam, Admiral James Bond Stockdale, then Commander Stockdale, commander of a fighter squadron aboard the USS Oriskany, was shot down over North Vietnam, captured and held for 7.5 harrowing years at the infamous Hanoi Hilton. Stockdale's ability to lead effectively in extremis conditions was largely due to his preparation. Stockdale's intellectual preparation included earning a master's in international relations from Stanford University in 1962, That preparation helped. That preparation helped him resist his brutal Vietnamese captors. Stockdale fought back in clever as well as courageous ways. When his captors told him that he would be paraded in public, Stockdale slit his scalp, creating streams of blood that marred his face. When they covered his head, he beat himself with a stool until his face was swollen and disfigured, all so he could not be used as a tool of communist propaganda. Stockdale's emotional preparation girded him against the fear and despair that one might naturally assume would be overwhelming in such extreme circumstances. Held in isolation and darkness for 4 years, his feet shackled for over 2 years, his hands often bound until they turned black. When asked about what prepared him for privation in captivity, Admiral Stockdale often pointed to the rigors of his plebe year at the Naval Academy. And I believe you're this going on a little bit longer than last year, I guess, or last couple of years. Sorry for that. But really, it is hardship that trains you to cope with these situations. And as an expert pilot, Stockdale's professional training had included what to do in event of capture. And he repeated this training with the pilots in his squadron. In the words of Seneca, he had pondered the evil in advance. Stockdale's ethical preparation is evident in his thoughts after exiting from his aircraft. As his parachute descended, Stockdale reflected, "I am leaving the world of technology and entering the world of Epictetus, the Greek Stoic philosopher whose code of self-control and fortitude Stockdale credited with helping him through his long activity." As the senior naval officer in the prison, Stockdale led prisoner resistance. Despite being tortured routinely, he created and enforced a code of conduct for all prisoners that governed torture, secret communications, and behavior. He expected his fellow warriors to live up to their values and preserve their honor. His fellow warriors followed Stockdale's example. Among them was fellow Navy pilot and Annapolis graduate John McCain, who today is again demonstrating extraordinary courage, honor, and commitment as he continues to serve while battling cancer. Please keep Senator McCain in your thoughts and prayers. Admiral Stockdale, through his deeds, demonstrated the essential characteristic of an in-extremis leadership: the subordination of a leader's well-being to the mission and to the well-being of his or her followers. Now, it is your turn. In the near future, sailors and Marines will look to you for leadership under difficult and sometimes dangerous conditions. They will expect you to put their lives, their well-being, and the mission above your own interests and your own safety and comfort. You must prepare. You must prepare intellectually so that the lessons of the past do not, in the words of the historian Carl Becker, lay inert in unread books. You must prepare emotionally and steel yourselves and your sailors and Marines against the debilitating effects of fear in combat through tough, realistic training. And you must prepare ethically by internalizing in yourself and internalizing in your fellow warriors your core values: honor, courage, commitment. You are now the custodians of the warrior ethos, and humanity and our nation needs America's warriors more than ever. The stakes are high, but we should be confident. I am confident. I'm confident because great institutions like Annapolis continue to develop young men and women like you, who are both able and willing to lead America's sons and daughters in times of peril. But I'm confident mainly because of each and every one of you in this hall, young men and women who volunteered to defend this great nation in time of war. I commend all of you for choosing service to our nation. It is a privilege, a great privilege for my wife Katie and I to be here with you today. My daughter Colleen is here with me, and my son-in-law, Lieutenant Lee Robinson of Army Rangers. It is wonderful to be with all of you. I commend all of you for choosing service to our nation. Thank you for hosting me. Go Army and go Navy. Thank you.